afternoon and welcome to today's edition of 4-H Live Online Learning. I'm your host for today, Blake Gasway. I'm the Community Engagement Specialist and the 4-H Youth Development Specialist in Pettis County. For those of you that don't know where that's at, if you've been to the State Fair in Sedalia, that's where I'm at. That's my backyard. So if you see me during the State Fair this fall, be sure and say hi and stop by. I also have 4-H responsibilities over Benton County and Henry County as well. So I hope you guys are excited today. We're out in my backyard. We're getting some fresh air, although the sun went away a little bit, so it's rather chilly right now, but I'm excited to be outside and get some fresh air and make a really fun project for you guys today, because we're going to be talking about a very fun thing in woodworking. I really enjoy it, and it's something I like to do. But before we get going, as we always do, is we need to say our pledges. So if you'll stand up and we'll do the pledges, and then we'll get into our project. So I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And then we'll do the 4-H pledge. I pledge my head to clearer thinking, my heart to greater loyalty, my hands to larger service, and my health to better living for my club, my community, my country, and my world. So as I said, today's topic, we're going to talk about woodworking. And I know that everything is kind of scary right now and things are way different. You're not able to go to school and get out and do other things. However, we're going to be okay. I know that we're resilient, and hopefully maybe this has given everybody a chance to have some fun and do something different. I know myself and my family, we just recently moved, which is partially why I'm out here in our backyard versus in a wood shop at the moment, because we haven't got everything unpacked, but we've been able to get outside and get in the garden and work on a blackberry bush and do some other projects and things. So even though it's different, I know we're going to be okay, and we have a lot of show me resilience, so we're going to be just fine. So as I said, today's project, we're going to be talking and doing a woodworking project. So growing up, I was very fortunate. I have lots of memories of doing woodworking with my parents and with my grandfather, making all kinds of fun things. And that was something that I thoroughly enjoy, and I still do. It's a way to get away from all the stresses and the normal things and just make something, and gives you a product that you can be proud of. So today, we're going to be making a bluebird house. So it's going to look something like this. It's a lot of fun, and there's several reasons why we chose to do a project like this as in a bluebird house. So one of the things that I want to remind everybody is before we do anything, before we do any of our woodworking, we want to make sure we're safe. We're going to be using power tools and lots of things, so we want to make sure we're safe, and we always want to have a parent or guardian with us to help us out, because we want to be safe and we don't want to have any accidents. Another important thing is we want to have eye and ear protection. So you can see I wear glasses. That covers my eyes for me to do it. I also wear a hat. That also cuts down on some of the sawdust being able to get around my glasses. So those are two important things. If you don't wear glasses, you want to wear some safety glasses of some kind, because there's lots of sawdust, lots of things, especially with doing it outside. The wind kicks up. It can blow that sawdust in your eyes, and you don't want that. It's not any fun. You can also choose to wear you can wear ear protection if you want to. I typically don't, but if you're comfortable and you want to do that, that is a-okay, and I would highly recommend it, particularly for some of the different tools. Not necessarily anything we're going to use today, but some of the other tools you can use can get really noisy. Like I said, we are outside, so the sound doesn't reverberate as much out here as it could in some spaces, but that is something that if you want to do that, I would highly recommend it as well, because you only have two ears, and that's all you get all of your life. So we want to make sure we preserve our hearing. We also want to be very careful too, because there's lots of ways that we can get hurt when doing woodworking. Obviously, we're working with saws and drills, and there's lots of sharp things and stuff like that that can hurt you and get you injured of some kind. But we also have to think about, there's splinters on the wood that we could get. There's also, if you're using screws, sometimes the machine that makes them isn't real calibrated, real great, and so there can be little fine metal pieces in it, and all kinds of other things you can do. So we want to be very careful. You also want to think about what you're wearing. So I put on a hoodie because it's rather chilly out here right now this afternoon, but we want to think about wearing clothing that's pretty tight, because there's lots of things that are spinning, and we definitely don't want to get a sleeve or part of our shirt caught up in a saw or something like that, because bad things happen when that does. So like I said, we always want to think about safety as number one and be very conscious of that. So the pattern we're going to make today, as I said, is we're going to be making a bluebird house. This pattern that I use to make this is from the Missouri Department of Conservation. So they put out several different builds that you can do for wildlife, which is awesome. It helps out the Missouri wildlife, but it's something that they have, and it's a really fun pattern to make. So thank you to the MDC group for putting that together and being able to give us a fun project like this. Something else too, that this birdhouse is typically going to be ideal for a bluebird. And so that's very important because we are going to help out Missouri's bird. So if you didn't know that, Missouri State Bird is a bluebird. So that's why we for sure want to build some houses and give our bluebirds somewhere to go. Ideally, you want to put your houses up any time of the year is a good time to do it. But particularly springtime is when they start finding where they can nest and they start having their hatches and all of these things like that. So we want to make sure we give them some ample space and some ample property or a house for them to use. Something too that's very specific about this pattern is it's what we call a one board pattern. So that's something that's pretty neat. As we said, it's as the name implies, a one board pattern. So it just takes one board to make the entire thing. So that's really good because if you know you have to scrounge around and find the materials or do something like that, you don't have to come up with lots of different boards. You can just get one board and you'll be set to go. So there's a whole line of one board patterns. One board patterns and things that you can make, but it's a lot of fun because, like I said, you can get everything you need out of just one board. So the board we're going to use today is a 1x6x6. And for those of you that maybe don't understand exactly what that is, we're going to talk about those. So the dimensions of this are 1x6x6, and that's how I went and purchased the board. And so what that refers to is the first part, the one, determines how thick it is. So it's going to be 1 inch thick. Then the second number, which is 6 in this case, determines how wide it is. So it's 6 inches wide. And then the last number, the third number, which is the last 6, is how long it is. So this happens to be 6 foot. So it's 1 inch thick by 6 inches wide by 6 foot long. So like I said, there's lots of ways you can buy wood like that. So if I told you we needed a 2x4x8, we would need a 2x4 that was 8 foot long. So that's how we're buying, that's how we're getting our wood today, is by the board. Now, something that's kind of a historical thing about the wood size that you might think about is actually where I told you that our board is 1 inch by 6x6. It's not really a true board. That's the nominal size of it. So given history a long, long time ago to when they used to cut boards many, many, many years ago, that was the true dimension of it. But by the time that they dried it out and they did all this stuff and the wood lost all the water that it needs to get down to the right level, the board shrink. And so they still stay true to what they're doing. And so if we look at it and we measure our board that I said was a 1x6x6, when we measure it, it's actually only 3/4 of an inch wide, thick rather, 3/4 of an inch thick. We measure it this way, it's only 5.5 inches, but it is true that it's 6 foot long. So that's another thing we gotta think about is when we're getting our board, no, it's just a little bit smaller than what we're buying. And like I said, that's an homage to the history of wood cutting, where it originally would have been that size, and then it shrinks as it loses water. So, as I said, we need a 1x6x6. We're also going to need a drill. We need some screws. The screws that I'm using are 1¼-inch screws. They are special screws. Something I forgot about the board to tell you was we're going to use pressure-treated wood. So this is wood that when it's cut, it's been put into a vacuum, a very, very large vacuum, and they suck all the air out of it, and they put in some treating chemicals, and so it helps it last longer and survive longer while it's outside, because the weather takes its toll on anything that any of the wood products we use. So when you get it, it might still be a little wet. This one's still a little bit wet, but that's okay. It does take a long time for them to dry. Like I said, they put it into a vacuum, they suck all the air out, and then they put in the treating chemicals, and because they've sucked out the air and it has the vacuum, it actually opens up the cells a little bit of the wood and lets it permeate in there and get inside it, and that prolongs how long our wood will last, which we want these birdhouses to last a long, long time. So when you get your screws, we do want to use special screws because of the chemicals that are put into the wood to treat it. We want to make sure we have this, some special screws that are also coated so that they don't have an adverse reaction to the wood. We're also going to need two different drill bits, an inch and a half drill bit, as well as a countersinking bit. If you don't have a countersinking bit, you can use just a pilot hole bit. You just need something to help where you're going to put your screws. And also same with the drill bit. If you don't have an inch and a half drill bit, you could use a jigsaw and cut it out. You could use a hole saw. You could use lots of other things, but I happen to have that. I'm going to use a miter saw today. So you need a saw of some kind. I happen to have a miter saw. I also have several different versions of circular saws. I have a nice little battery powered one, a smaller in size one that I'll also use. You can use a circular saw for all of this, or you could use, if that's the only option you have, you can use a handsaw. It is going to take you a little bit longer, but you're going to build some good muscles while you do it. We also need a pencil. We need a speed square. This is very important and very useful. If you don't know what it is, I recommend you look up one of these. They're very handy, gives you good measurements, and tells you good angles. And then we're also going to need a tape measure as well. So I like to tuck my pencil in my hat because otherwise I lose it and forget where I put it at. So that's everything we're going to need today. Give me a second. I'm going to move some stuff around, and then we're going to get started making our project. So as I said, I grew up doing woodworking with my parents and as well as with my grandpa. And so I made lots and lots of different projects in 4-H. I think I took woodworking almost every year in 4-H. I was a Clover kid for 3 years and then a 10-year member, so I was in 4-H a lot of years and thoroughly enjoyed it, and now I get to be a 4-H specialist and help everybody else in 4-H, which is a lot of fun. So again, I want to give a special thanks to MDC for providing our plans for our birdhouse that we're going to make today. All right. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to cut out all of our pieces. So as I said, this is a one board pattern, so we have to cut down everything we need before we get started. So I'm going to go ahead and get things set up here. Now something too that is interesting is my miter saw here. This is a 10-inch miter saw. And they make various sizes of ones, but that's determined by the size of the blade. So if you hear a 10-inch miter saw, that means it takes a 10-inch blade. Or if it's 12, it's 12-inch miter saw, that means it takes a 12-inch blade. Same with our circular saws. That's another way that they're measured as well, is based on the blade size. So the very first piece we need to cut is we're going to cut our roof. So it needs to be our 5.5 inches, which is what our board is, but it needs to be 6.5 inches long. So I'm going to take my tape measure, go to the center of the board, or roughly the center board. I'm going to mark 6.5. Now, one thing we want to think about while we're doing this too is that it'd be really easy for us just to mark the entire board up and start cutting. However, there's a thing that we have to account for called kerf. And so that is the loss of board you get from the blade when you cut it. So most blades are about 1/8 of an inch thick, give or take a little bit. It really just depends on how big the teeth are and some other things. But we got to account for that, because every time you cut, you lose a little bit of board on that cut. So we want to think about that. So I made my mark and at 6.5 inches for the roof. And like I said, we're going to cut a piece, then mark for the next one, then cut a piece, then mark for the next one, and keep working through our board until we get everything cut. So another thing I'm going to do too is comes in handy, is I'm going to grab our screw box, and I'm going to put it over here to help me hold up the board. Because we want to make this as easy as we can, so I'm going to use it to prop up my board so it's a little bit more level. I'm going to line it up with my mark. Sure, everything's good to go, and then I'm going to make my first. Alright, so that piece is for our roof. So the next piece we need to cut is for the front of our birdhouse. It's 9 7/8 of an inch long. Thankfully, this pattern doesn't take a bunch of pieces, but it's okay if you need to write on them. I think I'll be okay this time, but if it's something that you were making several of, you can write on here, whether you write on an edge or something that's going to be covered up, such as this is the top, so I know it's going to be like this. You could write on it and put that this is the top. That's a-okay, so we don't get our pieces screwed up. So the next one is the front. So this needs to be 5.5 inches wide by 9 7/8. So again, I'm gonna put my tape measure down, find 9 7/8. And if you do a lot of woodworking, you'll get a preference on how you wanna do it. But as I talked about the kerf and what you lose when you cut it, you also, when you put your line on, you wanna decide on which side of the line you're cutting. So for myself, it's just a personal preference that typically I will cut to the right of the line, so that's where my kerf is, because if you put it on the wrong side, you're going to lose a little bit of that length you need. Make sure everything's lined up. So that is the front. Now for the back piece, it needs to be 16.5 inches long. So that's going to be the longest piece that we have. So 16.5 inches. Remark this. And obviously if you were using a circular saw, you may want to take your speed square. I'm marking in the middle because that's the first contact for my miter saw. However, if I was using something like a circular saw to cut it, you could use a sawzall or jigsaw. You could use whatever you have, a handsaw. I might go ahead and mark it all the way across my board and get a good line so that I know exactly where that's going to fall at. But for mine, like I said, it falls right in the middle, so that's where I'm marking it. Make sure the board's all the way back against the fence. Now I have the back piece done. Okay, so the next piece we'll cut is the bottom. So it needs to be a 4x4 square. So we're going to cut 4 inches. So we'll mark that. And then we also need to cut the corners off, which we'll do that a little bit later, but that helps with the drainage of the birdhouse. So again, while you're cutting this stuff, you want to be as accurate and make as good a cuts as you can, but there does need to be some air holes in it, or like on the floor piece, it needs to have the corners gone, so if water gets in there, it can drain out. So we want to do the best we can, but it's okay if it's not, if things don't line up 100% exact. Make sure our board's back against our fence again. So as I said, for the bottom, it needs to be 4x4. So I've got 4 inches now, so I'm going to trim it the other direction. Make it 4 inches this way. So that gives me the bottom piece. I'll start over there. So next we're going to cut our side pieces. So as we looked at our birdhouse, look at it again, these side pieces have an angle on it. And like I talked about, there's this crack here that's very important to have some have a vent hole and let some air in. So that's on both sides, and that's done on purpose so that the birds can get some air in there and help with some ventilation. So what we need to do to mark for our side is one side needs to be 9 3/4 inch. So that's where the front is. So we're gonna find 9 3/4 and mark that. And then the back side, which we're gonna have to trim this board down some, but the back side needs to be 10 3/4. So if you do your math on this and use your triangle mathematics, you can figure out the difference on that, but I actually know that for a 5.5 inch board, it needs to be right about 12 inches is where it needs to be at. So I'm going to mark that. And then I'm gonna use my speed square just to make sure that I'm cutting correctly. I'm gonna use my speed square and draw across from both marks. Use the edge of my speed square to draw my angle to cut. Like I said, I happen to know that it's a 22 degree angle. So my miter saw has the ability that I can turn it and cut an angle. So I'm gonna turn it here to 22 degrees. Lock it back in place. Lean off against the fence here. Double check. However, as we cut this, you'll see that it didn't cut all the way through. That's because it's just a little bit bigger than it'll cut. But what I can do is I can put the blade the other direction. So I'm gonna put it 22 degrees the other direction, lock it back in, turn my board over, and use the hole that was already cut, and finish cutting it. So now I have one side piece. And then to finish cutting the other side, again, the front side needs to be 9 3/4. I'm going to measure down. Measure from that front edge. Nine and three quarters. I put my saw back to zero so I get a good straight cut. And then for this one, I'm going to go ahead and mark all the way across it with my speed square, just so I can follow the line a little better. Line it up and go ahead and make my cut. So there's the other side. And then we need to make a strip to put on the top of it. So that strip needs to be 3/4 inch by 5.5. So I'm gonna measure 3/4 inch. Make sure it's against the fence. And now we have the piece cut for that. So we will have a little bit left over, as we actually only need a 1 by 6 by 5, so we only need 5 foot. However, I just can't buy a board at anywhere I shop that's 5 foot long, so we have a little bit left over. So we'll discard that. So that should be all the cuts we need with our miter saw. So I'm gonna go ahead and take this off. Clear up my workspace a little bit. Bring back some of the other tools I need. Thank you. Okay, so first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to drill the hole for birds to get in and out. So it's really important that you use an inch and a half. Bluebirds, that's the average size according to the National Bluebird Society and many other places, is to use an inch and a half. Anything bigger than that, other birds will get in. Anything smaller than that, the bluebirds won't be able to get in. So that's really important to make sure we use the right size, as we want these for bluebirds, but there could be other birds try to get in and use it. So for our hole, if you look at the plan for it, it needs to be in the center of the front board, and it needs to be 2 1/4 inches down is where the center of it should be. So we're gonna mark 2 1/4. Down, and then we're going to find the middle of our board. Okay, so that's where our hole's going to go. And like I said, if you don't have an inch and a half bit, you can use a hole saw bit. You can cut out an inch and a half hole with a jigsaw or whatever else you would have to do it, but it is very important that we get that hole an inch and a half. So I'm gonna take my board, and where I'm gonna drill the hole, I'm gonna put it over the edge, because I really don't wanna drill into my table. That has happened a time or two, not on this table, but in other instances, and it'll probably happen a few more times, but we wanna pay attention to those things. So I'm gonna dangle it over. I'm also going to bring my thigh up to help brace it a little bit, because this bit, it has some teeth on it, and it'll catch the wood, and you want to make sure that we don't have it spinning around again. It's another way we can get hurt, is if the wood gets hung up on the bit. So we're going to drill the hole all the way through. So you might have to stop periodically and make sure that there's no wood on the teeth like it was there. And you also, as you're drilling, you might have to rock it back and forth just a little bit. All right, so I'm gonna clean the hole up just a little bit. So that's going to be our hole for the bluebird to come and go. All right, so next I'm going to take our bottom piece. So our little bottom piece, and like I said, we need to cut the corners off so that we can make sure it has some drain holes in case there is water or liquid of some kind get inside it. So I'm going to take my speed square and my pencil, and I'm going to mark these need to be, the edges need to be cut off 1/4 inch. So I'm going to mark 1/4 inch up, and then use my speed square to put it at a 45, and then we'll cut it off. Okay, so I've got those marked. Like I said, now I use the edge and make it a 45. That's what's nice about the speed square. As I said, it's got automatically a 45 on it, plus you can find other angles and such. It is a handy tool. Okay, so I've got my corners marked. Take this out. So now I'm going to cut those off. Like I said, I've got a handy little handheld circular saw here. It's super handy. I'm gonna use that to cut the corners off. Again, we wanna be very careful, make sure we don't actually cut into our table. So we cut our corners off like that, and so now it has the proper way to drain. If you don't have a saw that you can use, you can also drill some holes in it. That would be another option to give some drainage. So now we're going to start assembling. Before we do that though, we do need to cut part of our sides down, because in the plans, we know that this is a 5.5-inch board, but in the plans, it calls for the sides to be 4 inches. So we need to cut 1.5 inches off of the side of this. So I'm gonna go ahead and mark that. Mark the other one as well. Our two lines. Typically, I'll put a line towards the bottom and one towards the top, and then you can connect the two lines. If you give yourself at least two points, then you should be able to get a relatively straight line. So line those lines up and mark it. Same with the other one. Line them up and mark it. So you can cut these however you prefer to. I'm gonna use my circular saw and cut this off. You could use a jigsaw, handsaw, whatever it is, but I'm gonna use that to cut them off. And so again, we're just gonna take our time. We're gonna go slow because I'm not using a guide, so I'm gonna take my time and go slow, and we should be good. So again, I'll put it on the side, make sure I'm not cutting the table. Get it lined up. My battery is just about dead in my saw. So this happens sometimes when you're woodworking. My saw is almost out of juice, so give me a couple of seconds. I'm going to go trade it out and get a new battery. All right, so I have a new battery. It is important to make sure that you have those things on the charge, because they always go dead when you least need it. Okay, so we're going to finish cutting this board. So I have my first side cut. Now I'm going to cut the second side. Both sides are cut. So again, we're gonna clean off our area. Switch our battery over to our drill. Get this out of the way. Okay, so the first thing we're gonna do is we need to mark and drill some holes onto our front, because with our birdhouse, the front is going to sit with our sides behind it. So we're gonna drill into the front and assemble it like this. I'm just gonna put my drill bit in. Again, I have several, it's just my own personal choice that I like to use. A countersink bit a lot. That helps the screw get down and be flush so it's level, so it's smooth across the top of the head of the screw. If you don't have one, that's okay, but I would recommend using some sort of drill bit to help give you some holes to drill in, because if not, there's a real good chance you'll split your wood, particularly one like this, which is a little piece we got to put on the top. If you don't pre-drill it, you're probably going to split it when you're putting the screws in. So I'm gonna put two screws in. We're gonna put one at the top and one at the bottom on each side. So I'm gonna put my screws, I'm gonna measure down 1.5 inches, and then we're gonna put them in as well. So first things we're gonna do is mark down 1.5 inches on all the sides. We're going to kind of make our mark close to the side, because we don't necessarily want pencil marks all over this. 1.5 inches. Then we're also going to use, I'm going to use my speed square, and I'm going to mark 3/8 inch. Because we want to try to get our side right in the middle. So if we go 3/8, that'll give us close to the middle. So I'm going to put it on the mark that I just made and mark it at 3/8. Same thing on this side. Same thing over here. So now I'm going to drill them so we can get ready to screw them in. Find my mark. Try to hold my drill as straight up and down as I can. I'm going to drill. Change it over to the driver for the screws. And like I said, these screws are coated so that they don't have an adverse reaction with the chemicals that are put in the wood to make it treated. We'll go ahead and start them a little bit. And like I said, if you don't have the stuff to make this, you can always go back and follow along with the recording of this, as it's something that you may not have all the supplies you need, but that's okay. So now we're going to put one of our sides on. So we're going to line up our top here. Line up our bottom as well, and make sure it's flush on this side too. Like I said, I like to pre-start the screws so I don't have to mess with them when I get to this point. First one in. Put the second one in. So it should look something like that. Okay, so then we're going to do the other side, same thing. We're going to match them up. We're going to make sure it's flush on this side. Make sure the top and the bottom are lined up. And we'll have the other side on. Thank you. All right, so now we have our front and our sides on. Let's talk about putting on the bottom. So as we said, we have our bottom piece here. Let's see which way it goes in here the best. So I think it fits best that way. So again, as we look at our pattern, we know that we also need to have a little recess in here in the bottom for it. According to our instructions, it says 1/4 inch for the recess. So what that means is that that it's not, you see there's a little lip here, we need a little lip. We don't want it directly on the bottom. So it needs to be 1/4 inch up. So I'm gonna get my tape measure. Make sure we're at 1/4 inch. So it should look something like that. So it's not much, but it is up just a little bit. So we need to drill and put a screw on each side for this. So I'm gonna take it out. Change this over. So we know that for our hole, it needs to be 3/8 inch is where we're gonna put our hole to get into the center of our board, but we also have to shift it up 1/4 inch. So we go up 1/4 inch. And put a mark. We're gonna mark it widthwise. We're going to do that on the other two sides as well. Mark it from the bottom. We'll go up 1/4 inch, we'll go up 3/8 inch. 1/4 inch, 3/8. There's lots of math in woodworking, unfortunately, so if you're not good at math, you'll get better by the time you do lots of projects. So to mark where the center of the board is on this side. Mark where it is on this side. Okay. So we'll go ahead and drill holes for this. And if it's not quite in the center, that's all right. We're mainly just trying to put it on there so it holds the floor in. So we're gonna put our piece back in, our floor back in. Make sure it's up 1/4 inch. Make sure it's all the way in there. I'm gonna screw it down. Side over here. All right. So now we have our bottom put onto it. My countersink bit back in. So now we have our front, our sides, and our bottom put on. So the next piece we want to do is we want to put on the back. So the bottom of our birdhouse, so not the floor, but the very bottom where our sides and our front meet, it needs to be 3 inches from the bottom of the board. So when we drill this, we're actually going to be drilling on the back side versus on the front side. Like these, we drilled on the front, or on the side, we drilled on the face that you'll see and drilled into it. This one, we're gonna be putting the screws in on the back. So we need to put our screws about an inch and a half up. So if we have our 3 inches from where the bottom of it's gonna start and our inch and a half, then we need to measure up 4.5 inches. And then the other screw that we're gonna put in the top, I'm gonna mark it at 11 inches from the bottom. That's gonna give it a little bit of room so that you don't run it through, because something we have to think about is when we're putting our screw in, if we get it too high, we'll run through and poke out the front of the board. So we don't wanna do that. So I'm gonna mark my 3/8 again. So we can drill them. Now this birdhouse too is also made for the roof to come off, so I'm going to put another screw in the floor back here, because if we need it, we're going to take the top off of it, because you want to periodically check these and make sure that you cleaned it out and everything like that. So on our bottom, I know that we need to put this screw in the middle of the bottom. So we're going to know that the board's gonna start at 3.25 inches. And so I need to go 3/8 of an inch up from that. Find the center real quick. So we should have 5 holes to drill. So I got all 5 drilled, and I'm going to switch back over. Go ahead and get my screws. Go ahead and start these. Go ahead and make myself a little guide of where the bottom needs to start. So I'm going to measure from the bottom, put a little faint mark at 3 inches on both sides of this, so that way I know where the bottom of my sides go on the front of this board. Turn this over, look for that mark. If you're struggling with that, another thing you can do is put it on the edge. So I found my mark. I'm gonna put it on the edge so it's a little easier to see. So now I can look on the side of the board right here. Instead of having to look at the underside, I can look at the side of the board. Make sure it's lined up. Yep, looks pretty good. I'm going to go ahead and drill these in. Okay, so now our birdhouse has been attached to our back. So next thing we need to do is we need to put on our top, as well as we need to put on this little strip that we cut off. that will help keep the top on. So we're actually going to put it on first. See how this looks with our... So on this strip, like I said, it's really easy to break it with the wood grain sometimes. So it's very important that we want to pre-drill it. I'm going to switch back over to my countersink bit. This would be an ideal time too think about if you had another drill, you could set up and put your drill bit in one and your driver in the other and use that so you don't have to keep taking it out. I'm going to measure over, get on our board here, inch and a half on both sides. And again, this just helps make it easy so that literally there's just one screw holding on the lid, so that it makes it easier when you put it out to go check it, because that is something that you want to do periodically. So find 3/8. Now this project too, this is something that you could do with nails if you didn't have screws. I grew up in a household, like I said, working in the wood shop, and we believe that we screwed everything together. So that's just a personal preference. You could use nails, but I prefer to use screws because that's just what I learned to use. But also, they don't come out as easy as nails do. Nails will eventually work out. Screws don't do that. So that's just a personal choice, so that's why I'm using screws. So I'm going to drill this. Driver. Okay, so now that we've got the screws in our little piece here, then we're going to make sure there's nothing in our birdhouse and take our top. Take our roof and put it on there like it would go. Then we'll put that strip down on it. Make sure it's flush on both sides with the back. And I'm going to push it down as tight as I can get it. You might have to use your leg again to brace your birdhouse. And I'm going to go ahead and screw these in. So it should look something like that. Now, like I said, because you have this strip here, all you have to do is put one screw in your roof, so that then when you hang this up and you go check it, all you gotta do is take that one screw out and take it out and clean it out. You can get in there, see if anything's in it, and then it's pretty easy. So like I said, you wanna do that periodically, especially if you wanna kinda monitor it too, to make sure there's not other birds living in it. There are other birds that we'll get in there, but like I said, if you use the inch and a half hole to put in there, that deters some of them, because obviously we want to give homes to our bluebirds specifically. So now for our top, we're going to put it in the little groove that we created here. Make sure it's flush on the back, flush on the front. And I'm going to put a little mark down here and over here to serve as a guide where we should put our screws in. So my mark is basically straight across like this, so that I know where I should drill a hole in here, because it's at an angle. So I'm going to use my speed square draw a light mark in the middle there, where I think it's gonna go. And mark here. So like I said, then I know where this hole needs to be. So I'm gonna put it back in the slot. Make sure that's where it should be. Then I'm gonna try to keep the same angle. And if you don't get the angle right, it's okay. You can always adjust your screw, put it in a little different if you need to. So your hole should be at an angle. So the board's gonna sit something like this and your hole is gonna be like that. So when we drill it, we have to make sure we drill at an angle. Go ahead and start my screw. Make sure there's nothing in the birdhouse. Line up with the back and with the front. And then screw my screw in. So you can check to make sure it's got a good seal. So like I said, it just takes one screw to hold the lid on. So whenever you put it out, when you go clean it out, you can take the screw out, take a screwdriver with you, take it out. You don't even have to take it off the post. And with that last screw, you've completed your bluebird house. So again, these vents here, same with here, those are very important so they can get some air. Same with on the bottom. You cut the corners off for some drainage. If you can't do that, you can drill some holes in it. But that is your finished birdhouse. It's good to go as it is. You don't have to paint it. If you do want to paint it, they recommend a light color like a tan or a light brown, really, really light brown. But this should last years and years because it's made out of wood that's been treated like we talked about in the beginning. And so we want to point this towards the east if possible. So when you put it out, if you put it on a pole, the most ideal way that the experts tell you is that you want to point it to the east and you want to put it on a pole, something that helps with some of the other things that might kill the bluebirds. So like if you put it on a tree, a cat could climb up there, or a raccoon or something else. Or if you put it on a fence, they could do the same thing. Same with snakes and stuff like that. So we want to give them the best habitat they can. So point it towards the east, put it on a pole. If you need to put a predator loop around the bottom, you can. That's something you can look up and do if you want to help make sure that they're getting left alone. And then you need to put it between 4 and 6 foot off the ground. So if you do those things, put it like in a pasture somewhere, or you can put it on in your backyard on a fence. Also, if you have more than one birdhouse, you want to put them about 100 feet apart because they are kind of territorial. We're going to put these up in our backyard and we're going to have bluebirds for years to come. It's going to be something that's going to be here a long time. So hopefully you guys have enjoyed the lessons today that we've had. Again, I'm Blake Gazaway, your host for today. I've thoroughly enjoyed talking with you guys, and I'm so excited for the State Fair this year because I expect to see a bunch of these birdhouses at the State Fair and know that I am going to take the time to go and look at them and look in the 4-H building and look at the stuff and look for these. So please make some of these. Take them to the State Fair and then put them out. Again, as you're watching this, put your comments on here. Tell us where you're listening or where you're watching from, that you had a good time, and take pictures of the build as you do it. Also, post pictures of the final product where it's out. That's how we know what all of our 4-H'ers and our non-4-H'ers that are tuning in are doing. Make sure too, if you're interested in woodworking or some of the other projects that we have in 4-H, we have tons and tons of things to do, but contact your local extension office, or you can always talk to the state office, Missouri 4-H. You can talk to them. They'll help get you in touch with your county person, because we want everybody to be in 4-H and have a lot of fun with our group. We do have a lot of fun, and we get to do great things like this. So please, like I said, comment where you're watching from, and also share some pictures of you guys building these and showing us what you're doing, because that helps us and gives us some exciting things to know that people are out there, and of course the bluebirds are going to love it. So until I see you hopefully at the State Fair or see you sooner, I'm Blake Gazaway. Thanks for tuning in for today's edition of 4-H Live Online Learning.